have culture on tap tonight. We have a special guest. But before making that introduction, I was told to make a few pitches. So I'm a person that follows directions. So I want to speak a few moments about Science Fest. This is one of our initial events. Science Fest is a four-day festival. It's our signature event that celebrates our heritage and history and science, and here for the whole family. And Los Alamos Main Street produces Science Fest in collaboration with the Los Alamos Creative District and Los Alamos County. It partners with other organizations, and thank you to Uncorp for supporting us. Organizations and individuals that have helped build this festival by hosting and championing programs such as the one tonight. So I urge you all to check out losalamosciencefest.com for a full list of events that will be happening in Los Alamos in the next few months. And speaking of the Creative District, the Creative District develops and promotes the unique and deep creative culture in all areas, including art, history, science, and culture. And in the year of culture, we're honored to introduce our speakers tonight. We have with us Prince Zuko and his wife, Nosizewe, who are visiting Los Alamos from South Africa. And before saying anything, my wife, in the back, and I spent a month in Southern Africa, and we just love the vistas and the animals. And, but most of all, we love the people and the culture, so we're excited to have you. And we often say that Los Alamos, because it's a remote location, it's hard to get here by accident. But it turns out that's exactly what happened last year. So in the case of our visitors, they were here with African musicians and were delivered by shuttle from Albuquerque to the Hampton Inn in White Rock, expecting to be walking distance to the Santa Fe International Folk Art Market, where they were supposed to perform. And as you know, we may be close to Santa Fe, the edge of Santa Fe County, but we're not close to the Museum Hill or where the Museum Hill. So fortunately for them and for us, they were put in touch with Deborah Sorensen. And we have Deborah right here. And she's now our official goodwill ambassador because she rallied friends and family to transport Zuko and his group around Los Alamos and showed them to Los Alamos and Santa Fe and found them other venues to perform. So we couldn't ask for a better ambassador. So thank you, Deborah, very much. You make us proud. So some of you may know, Zuko had planned to bring another group of musicians back to Santa Fe and to perform at Science Fest. But there were visa issues that got in the way, but Zuko and his wife came on their own accord to keep their commitment to come speak with us tonight. So we're very appreciative of that. So tonight, Zuko will speak about his childhood, his tribe, and his country, his position as prince in cultural development initiatives, and entertain your questions. So I'd like to introduce him. I have a long name myself, so I'll try to do it carefully. So, Prince Zuko Jongizilo Kokwana Kaj Min Ziwa. To us. Thank you.
Good evening. It's early hours of the morning in South Africa right now. So people are going to wake up very soon and go to work. We come from an area in South Africa called the Eastern Cape along the Indian Ocean. And this is right at the bottom of the continent, for those who have no conception of where South Africa actually is. Right at the bottom, and we enjoy two oceans, and the meeting of those two oceans, the Atlantic Ocean and the Indian Ocean. And the meeting point is where what we call the Cape Point, right in Cape Town. So we are from a tribe called Amazizi, and it's a tribe that was formed you know, over thousands of years ago, because our lineage goes, you know, over 20, 30 generations back. And we can trace it with the help of written records to reference dates. We can trace it before Christ was born. So it's quite a long history. And this tribe resides within the Abatem kingdom. So this is our, this is basically 10% of our tribal wear, because we wouldn't be wearing, you know, pants like this, and we would be wearing, I should be having more of this wrapped around, and same goes with my wife, but that, we reserve that for special traditional occasions in the village. So that's where personally I was born, and I grew up in the royal house, in the Popana royal house, which is the ruling family of the tribe. So, and our childhood is such that when a child is born, within 8 days or within 8 days or so of the child birth, in fact, 14 days go by, and then when the woman comes out of the seclusion period where she would have been kept company by other women in the village and midwives, you know, after giving birth, so she doesn't see anyone, she doesn't do anything for 14 days, she's taken care of strictly. And so when she comes out of that, she comes out and the man will see the child for the first time. And so I was one of those, and then I was presented to the kraal where the cattle sleep. They take you there and they do a ritual introducing you to the ancestors to say, we have a newborn in this family, and here is this newborn, and the name that we're giving him is so-and-so. And then they do this ritual about how the people that departed, that is the ancestors, how they must now take care of you. So the elders almost like temporarily hand you over to the departed one. And because that period of time until you can speak, you know, as you know, even in your own culture, you just predict what the child is, whether it's comfortable or is complaining about something, they are not speaking for themselves. And so in our culture, we ask that there is a spiritual mediation, so that when the child may fall sick and we don't know what's happening, then we are able to go to the diviners that will then channel that energy that was, you know, asked for by the elders, so that we can find out what's wrong with the child. So we grow up and boys do boys' things, you know, go and head up the cattle and the sheep, and you spend most of the day in the field, you know, practicing stick fighting, and, you know, just enjoying yourself, really. There's, as a boy, up to about the age of about 17, you've got very little responsibilities. In fact, you're allowed to misbehave, because once you go to initiation school at the age of about 19, 20, you are not allowed now to misbehave anymore. And if you misbehave, it's punishment. Depends what you would have done. You can pay a cow or things like that, you know, that are quite expensive. And a cow is a very highly priced, I don't know if the word commodity, asset in our culture. And animals in our culture are part of the human beings. You can't separate the animals, because our lives are intertwined with the animals. We give them names, like you would give names to your pets, and we give names to the cattle. So one cattle in the kraal will be responsible for the spiritual health of the entire family. That is, my grandfather, his brother's children, and their children end up being like a group bigger than this of the family. And they depend on a particular cow, you know, for specific rituals. So, for example, then in the case of females, because the males, the boy will grow up, and then at the age of 18, 20, we go to the initiation school, and we, after 6 weeks, we are supposed to really have changed and to become, you know, adults, very responsible, very respectful, and if you don't do that, you get fined, as I said. But whereas the ladies here, they grow up, and when they get to the age of about maybe 14, and they start going to, on their period, and they taken to an initiation school for ladies or young girls, because that's really young girls at that age. And they are taught about, you know, their body, how the body functions, and how they should relate to other girls and to the opposite sex, and all of that, and what it means now that they are growing up. And there's a seclusion period for them as well of about 6 weeks or so. And at the end of that, there's a big feast, and they come back, and the people in the village have not seen them for that 6 weeks while they were away, and there's a big feast. So, you know, so when I was then growing up in this period of boyhood up to age of 19, when I went to the initiation school, the elders in the village, if you are the next in line in the royal line, there are certain things that you can't do. You can't go playing skateboards, if I was growing up in town, for instance. Or you can't just do any regular things that boys in your age do all the time. There's times they call you and sit you down, and they relate to you these stories about your history, your culture, traditions, the norms, the values, the music, the food, the dress, the different roles of women and men, boys and girls, and the elders. Now, the interesting thing about the elders is that the elders are the government. In fact, they are the law. They're not just the government, they're the law. They dictate what should happen and what should not happen. And they do this in the interest of the village. So this morning when we went for breakfast at the Baptist church, I saw a nice body of elders, and they reminded me of our village back home. When the elders must meet, the elders meet. There are no excuses, or we can't meet the quorum, therefore we need to meet next week. The elders will stop at anything to make sure that if there's supposed to be a meeting, they will be there. Sometimes there's nothing to discuss. It's just that they need to be there. For instance, if something happens, your daughter is getting married, the day before, the days leading up to that, the elders will spend a lot of time. So the old men will spend a lot of time next to the prod in your house, doing nothing, just chatting. They are giving dignity to your house in case people coming from far, they arrive here, they must be welcomed by the body of the elders in the village. And they will dictate, based on the stature of the person arriving, they will dictate what must happen. Whether we slaughter for that person, we slaughter a cow or a sheep to welcome them, whatever that needs to be done. Where are they going to sleep? You know, what are the things that we should do for them? Who else that this person should meet? All of those things are decided by these elders. But there's no program. You know, they will just come and sit there and just be and just chat. And part of that chatting, we call it imbadu. And imbadu is just, you know, could be girls, you know, it's just age mates, really. People of the same age getting together and just talking about things and life and the culture and traditions as it relates to them and their age, trying to understand it better. And if there's things they don't understand, then they need to go back and ask questions to the elders and come back. So the imbadu then is that conversation of stimulating knowledge and how to absorb this energy. Because our history, culture, and traditions and all of that is not written down. Well, only now are we, you know, starting to do that. But all of these years, over 2,000 years, it was not written down. And we rely on the elders. Now, if the elders choose to drink a lot of alcohol and they don't care what's happening, that village gets lost. Because the young people will take over and they will just say, you know, like, let's just take a shortcut, I'm tired of this. And then they will just do as long as, we call it in our language, upela sonwabe. You want to do something just for the sake of having done it, and then we get done with this and then we move on. Whereas the elders will want a very strict process to things, and it normally takes longer, but it has to be done like that. Our funerals, for example, will take up until 3 o'clock in the afternoon. From basically, they don't even start that same day; they start like on Thursday, And, you know, with a series of things that are happening on Friday, certain people are arriving, certain things are happening, 7 o'clock in the morning, we're slaughtering the boys. They've got their own role, the women, you know, the men, the younger men. There's three stages of each, you know, the men, there's three stages, and the women, there's three stages. And each have got, like, their body of authority, which is the elder. So the elder, the women, will dictate what will happen around the issues that involve all women coming down. But now the trick is that the elderly women will also make the men believe that they are in charge of things in the village. Meantime, the men are actually taking instructions. Every night, when you go to bed, you get these instructions. And you wake up and you must pretend to the men as if you are the one who's coming up with these things, and you call a meeting of the men. And many times the women pretend as if they don't know what the meeting is about next to the cross. And it's almost like they're kind of fooling us. But I don't know. So I hope my wife will change that around. So for example, if any of you travel from here, you know, so far to come and visit us, we must slaughter for you. But if my wife is away, maybe in another village, and I can't reach her on the phone in the context of today because we've got phones, she can't just come back and there's blood I've slaughtered. You know, that will cause a big fight. I must try to delay the situation, come up with things to do until she comes back, and then discuss with her, you know, what are we going to do about these people? And she will say, but what do you mean? You know, you have to slaughter for these people. You can't just be. And I'll be like, yes, yes, you are right. And, you know, I'll go and I'll send the boys, bring one sheep, a big one, depending on how much I want to impress the person. If it's Deborah, I'll get the biggest one. And, you know, we take it. So, like, if we are in a house like this, we take the sheep and we take it up to the door to show you, and we address you in a way almost like mediating to the ancestors as well. And the elders will stand up, maybe three or four of them, appealing to the ancestors that we are slaughtering this sheep not only for food, but the blood is to mediate and to appeal to the ancestors to protect you and to, you know, for good health while you are with us, you know, and that you should not fall sick or anything. And should you fall sick, you know, we also appeal that then the ancestors, together with your ancestors, must help us to be able, if we consult a diviner, to be able to channel that energy. Because we believe if we have not done that, the diviners will look and they will not find. You know, what is called the diviners here?
Like,
no, like your, you know.
To find water?
The spiritual mediators. Like these people that can speak to the mediums. Yes. Yes, we have those. And it's a very important part of our culture. You don't consult them every time. You know, if you don't study, the next thing you think you must consult them for to pass exams. You're not going to pass exams. You have to study. But if there's some spiritual problem, then you consult them. So this is the kind of setup that we grew up in. And, you know, we get to the town. I mean, like, this is a city for where we come from. You know, like, we have a really nice and rural setting that is totally different from town. And we go to town maybe at the age of about 15, 16, some 18, some, you know, 20 after initiation, after, you know, going to the initiation school. And then they go to find jobs or pursue, that go to university and all of that. So personally, I first lived in town when I was 15. And that's when I pursued further my studies in oral history and doing research, you know, on written records that were there, on the archives. So we've got national archives in four different areas around the country. And we've got a few universities that have got research libraries, very strong research libraries. And part of those links are the University of London, for instance, University of London in London, and the University of Australia. they've had a lot of academics coming to South Africa to research and go back, and some of those dissertations and master's thesis and all of that, they are in their libraries. So we're always constantly trying to get hold of those and read more to find sometimes, because most of it we have our history orally, but we want to find dates. You know, around what time was this happening? And you go and read and you find. So that after you've been researching for maybe 5-10 years, then you get to be very good in knowing how to find the information easily from people's journals. Somebody would have been traveling around. You said you were in Southern Africa recently. So in the context of, 300 years ago, you would have had your diary and you would have written so many things about people you met and all of that. And that will be in some university somewhere. And so when we're looking for certain dates, maybe when you got there, something big happened that changed the course of history. And that diary could be the only link to the correct date of when this actually happened. So we have those records from the Greeks and all of that, 900 years before Christ was born, those kinds of things. And that's how we found that body of wealth of knowledge very very attractive. So, I mean, we're talking about a culture, a heritage of a people, customs, and all of that. I can talk for the next 40 years. The best would be, to allow for an interaction, some questions.
Well, I wanted to know, how did you become, I'm Kelly Stewart, by the way, with Los Alamos County Economic Development. And Deborah, just so you know, Deborah sent her email, talking about her experience and knowing that Zuga was coming back to 311. Is anybody interested? We were all just thrilled and so excited that you were able to come anyway. But you're the CEO of a cultural development company, is that what
yes.
you call it? Can you talk about how you got into that?
Yes, you see, then, because of the upbringing in a tribal setting, and because of this history and knowledge and heritage that was imposed on me, I developed I found it imperative that my work should revolve around the arts, the creative industries. And that's how I got to work with cultural groups, choreographing cultural productions and cultural performances. We have started in our village a cultural festival, for example, an annual cultural festival where 15, 20 groups perform. This year we hope it's going to be over 2 days. And so this is something that's happening. It's not something we interact with at a particular time. In fact, let me put it this way. In our culture, any kind of an event, there's going to be a song, there's going to be a dance. Somebody's dead, there's songs for that about mourning, about giving people hope. And there's dances for that as well. So you might find people dancing and think that they're disrespectful. But there's this particular thing is for that particular occasion. A child is born, that's happening. A young lady is getting married, lots of songs and dance and all of that. And these things happen. It's not something, it's not a short performance for half an hour. It's over days. Happens over days. And in fact, in December, we almost could say it's a month-long festival. Because your daughter is getting married, and you're doing something else, and they're doing something, and everything is like today and tomorrow and the other day. And the village, throughout that time, is engulfed in song and dance for all these different occasions. There's just no way that you can be separated from that. So that's how we got to do that. And we, about maybe 15 years ago, 12, 15 years ago, we started to get involved in, let me put it this way. In the year 2000, which is 15 years exactly ago, we had a group of experts in arts administration and projects management in the arts that came from from Denmark and Norway, and they also we also linked up with the Australia and an organization in Australia called Oz Music. And they had a lot of material in Australia about, you know, training material for arts administrators and project managers. And these ones in Norway and Denmark had people that were willing to come and train people in our country to be teachers of arts administration, focusing specifically on the, you know, indigenous arts and culture and traditions. Not bringing just, you know, everything and just telling us how we should do things. And we took this, and I was one of the 20 people. And we took that, and that's when then I formed the company, Voices Were Global. In fact, it has gone through a bit of rebranding. It was Voices Were Entertainment, then it became Voices Were Travel, and then it's now Voices Were Global. So after doing that course, and after, you know, we started to know people now in Ireland and everywhere else, and it was easy for us to be recognized by government when government wanted to do cultural productions outside of the country through our embassies. So I would get a phone call, can you get us a group and bring the group and make sure the group will represent the country, and maybe there's two or three groups, and we bring them to, for instance, maybe to here or to France or wherever, and there they will find us other, you know, performers that we must now, you know, do a joint production with, and they would need somebody to do all of that. And so I was enjoying it in the beginning. So I would do all of this traveling and spend a little time in the village. But when I went back to the village, the elders would make sure that you are grounded now. You switch off your cell phone and you must listen to us. So all the time, they always like make sure that you know that they are the ultimate government. It doesn't matter if you've got a call about a $1 billion business. The elders will tell you, put the phone off and listen. Because that man will come and go. This is the destiny of your grand and great-grandchildren. And the whole idea is that the elders are saying, preserve the culture, but because you young people of today, you may be the head of the village, the tribal leader of the village, but you don't want to stay here full-time. So use the fact that you are traveling to America, to China, to everywhere, use that opportunity to export the knowledge and the richness, you know, of the culture and how we can learn from other countries how they're doing things. And let's use that to improve this very same culture and also the people. How do we do links that make sure that we impact on job creation in our areas and, you know, the community development projects. So the company then is spearheads that. But we've recently now, last year, we formed a Community Development Trust, which is an NGO, or an NPO, I don't know which one you use. NGO? Yeah. So which is an NGO, and it does all of this work. So for instance, if the bridge breaks down, it will irritate government until they build a new bridge. It doesn't go and ask them for money, but it just irritates them, and it causes all sorts of attention to them. You know, goes to the opposition parties in parliament, tell them about this problem, and then go to the ruling party, tell them that their local guys in Los Alamos, the federal government report, Los Alamos is not fixing the bridge, the mayor, I don't know what's his problem, and eventually nobody in a political space wants to be talked very bad because they want to be re-elected. So they will quickly fix the bridge. So it's things like those that we do, and that's how we get to come to Los Alamos last year.
Question, how big is your village?
Our village has got 50,000 people.
Wow, that's a village.
Is that big?
That's big. That's
Santa Fe.
Yes. Our county is 18,000, the entire county.
Yes, our village is quite big. It's about 50,000 people, about 200,000 cattle. You know, over 100,000 sheep, 300 of those belong to us, and 100 chickens. I see your daughter is
do they
coming
ever
along.
Have time to work? So they're always partying, 50,000 people. Somebody has birthed you, or somebody's getting married, so.
In fact, Saturdays are for funerals. You can't get married on a Saturday, for example, because people are not allowed by morals to celebrate when somebody has died. So Saturdays are specifically for funerals. So you can do something maybe on a Friday or on Sunday, you know, or on any other day during the week. And Tuesdays and Thursdays are for the tribal meetings. So Thursdays is to try cases. It's like a court in the different villages. Basically, the village, even though it's got 50,000 people, is divided into six, like you call them here, reservations. We call them administrative areas. So the six administrative areas, they've got their sub-government structures. If you've done something wrong, we won't call 50,000 people to a court. The people in that village will try that case, and if you disrespect them, it will be then escalated to our court. And if it comes to our court, then you are in a big trouble.
Yes. So.
From 1800, 215 years. In fact, the first person from our area to convert to Christianity, it was the year 1800 on the dot. So it's been 215 years now that we've had Christians. And Christianity is very big. And because of the way it was introduced, it was such that, you know, if you don't align yourself somehow with Christianity, you are going to go to hell and all of that. And so people said, okay, I don't mind, going to church sometimes on Sunday so that I don't go to hell, but my African tribal culture remains intact. It won't be disturbed by this, but, you know, just so that I don't have a problem with any of the two gods. And we don't have Islam, for example. Yes. Sorry, let me do it.
Oh, I was just thinking that you said actually you didn't go into your actual villages until you were 15 years old or so. You stayed out in the rural areas?
No, I did not leave the village until I was 15.
Right.
Yes.
So this 50,000 people involves all the rural areas as well?
The 50,000 people is the, it's like if I'm the governor of Los Alamos, you've got out 18,000? Yes. Mm-hmm. If I'm the governor of Los Alamos, then there's 50,000 people in Los Alamos in the different areas.
Bailey County.
It's a county, eh?
County.
It's quite an area, but we don't see it that way because it used to be bigger than that. Mm. You know, so we still want more land.
So you spoke to the three different levels of ages that you break down your men and women to. Could you talk a little bit more about that?
So the first age, now, the women, the girls and the boys, this is, the girl is somebody who's not married and who's of a younger age. Because if you're not married but you are of, you know, like over 20, those kinds of age 30, you are not a girl. You know, we have a word for maybe lady, but it describes that you are unmarried. And it's not demeaning or anything, but it's just to make sure that if somebody were to be interested to marry you, they don't get mistaken that, you know, this is somebody's wife, and then you lose out on that opportunity. So it's a distinction, it's just descriptive way. So, and then, and also for a man, you know, who has gone to initiation school, but he has become now, we call it umfana, the first stage of manhood, which is maybe about your 15, 18 years. You are on stage one of manhood. You're no longer a boy now. And until you're about, let's say, about ages of about 35, 36, and then you get promoted to the second stage of manhood. And this first stage is about doing things. You know, you are just the doers, you are the soldiers. If this table must be shifted there, so I will say, for instance, move this table there, and even if there are some men closer to that table, The men that are on the second stage and the last stage, which is the elders, they're not going to even move. And people from there and there, and if they're not here, somebody must go and call them and tell them to move the stage. So these are the doers. And then the second stage, which by rank, you know, I'm on, is this is the stage of people that are monitoring what's happening. The elder says, move this table, and these young men don't move it. My age mate, we're supposed to deal with these young men that are not doing this because they're disobeying the elders. You know, that kind of vibe. So we are there for that, to make sure that there's order and things are done, things that are meant to be done.
Enforcement.
Enforcement.
Your enforcement.
Yes. And then you have the elders who are really, you know, we see the elders at an advanced stage. We see them in a stage between us, the living, and the departed ones. So much that when they speak, we listen beyond listening. We tune in another frequency now. Especially if an elder, you know, is quite old and you don't even have to be sick, but you know when you are really like aging, we want to keep everything that he's saying now. To a point that on the day that he's going to pass on, he will know. And he will maybe in the few days want to invite some of the key people that he wants to see before he goes. He's not even sick, but he just knows because of the spiritual connection. He knows that his time has come. And he will invite certain people, and on the time, on the day that he's going to go, this is what happened to my grandfather in 1996. So I was, you know, in Mtata in town, and we were called to come. I don't even remember what was the reason why we should come, but we came to the village. And so we just sat there and chatted. And he was 92 years old. He was not sick, nothing. No complaining about anything. And suddenly, you know, around midday, and the day was just clear, but around midday, clouds came by, and then it started raining. And she called my younger sister that comes after me to come and sing a particular song. And now some of us, you know, like we are now just on the other house or, you know, just chatting, because in the village you've got many houses. People may be on the other house, but you are on the other house, you don't know what's happening that side. And my sister sang and whatever else, and she asked for a short prayer, and there were a few other people in the house that my grandfather had invited. And so from the other side, you know, the rain was like maybe 3 minutes, and it was gone. And so when we came out, the sun comes out again. So you just come outside, and the door was closed in the hut where my grandfather was. And that's a sign that somebody old has passed on. Especially the hut being closed, the whole door, and the rain, that very, like, 3 minutes rain. You don't even need anybody to tell you what happened. You know already. And everyone in the village will know that, oh, you know, this is not a normal rain. And that's why I'm trying to illustrate that the elderly people are revered, because they are not considered to be full-time in the physical world reality. That they are, you know, so almost in between the two spaces, and they are mediating directly at that stage, we take it. They're mediating directly with the afterlife. And they may say certain things at that moment, shortly before they pass on. And whatever they say has to be done precisely the way that they say, or, you know, something very bad will happen.
Thank you.
And with the women, with the women, just to illustrate a bit. So with the women, the first stage, you know, is, we call it umchagas or umakoti. And this is the bride. But you remain a bride for a couple of years. You know, you're not a bride for a weekend. And so for 3 months or 6 months or 1 year, depending on how much you are able to do that, you must come and live with your mother-in-law and your father-in-law, so that they can teach you the, you know, all of the wealth of knowledge in this family. And for the mother-in-law, and the bride to find each other. Because as you know, that's sometimes not very easy. But then if they stay together, they will, you know, have their own tantrums and all of that. But after 6 months or 8 months, they become the best of friends. And they miss each other and all of that. And now, you know, people are like, wow. You know, they can't even distinguish. An elderly woman will be walking with the daughter-in-law, and people will think that's her daughter. You know, that's how close they grow. After that stage, you become in the intermediary stage. And same with women, they must make sure that the young women know what they're supposed to be doing and things are happening. And the elderly women, they just must say what must happen. In fact, the elderly women don't even have to say what must happen, because they are kind of instructing the men on the one side and instructing the younger women on the other side. And so they just, in the day, you'll find them just sitting next to the hut, smoking their long pipes, just chilling. And you will think they're doing nothing. Meantime, they're just watching. Look at those fools. We instructed them to have this meeting, and now they're having it. But they're not inviting us, because they don't realize that we're the ones that are dictating what must happen in that meeting.
Did you already talk about how, when I stepped out, how the wife takes on the men, the man's, and the new name?
Yes, yes. So when you marry, the lady, that the bride, you know, the bride can no longer use their own name, like your maiden name. When you marry into my family, you'll be given a new name. That name will be something along the lines of what is expected of you. So each time people are calling you by that name, they are reminding you of who you are and what is expected of you and what you mean in this family. And so you then have to use that name now, and no one can call you by your maiden name. Even if you come from the village across here and all of these people have known you, even if you actually come from this same village and you marry someone in this village, everyone is no longer allowed to use your maiden name. Because if they do, they are fine the cow. Because it's like they are belittling you, they are taking you back to childhood when you are now a woman, a full woman, and you've changed your dress code and everything, and suddenly now they're taking you back, demeaning you, demeaning the family, demeaning your family and the family you're married to and your husband, so they must pay a cow to apologize.
May I ask how old you were when you got married?
We've been together for over 10 years, but we've been married for less than that. And so she was much younger, and I was in my mid 20s. Normally, you come back from the initiation school, and you know, like maybe at the age of 19, 20, and at the age of maybe 23, you would marry. But we've since changed that. We find that, you know, just, you know, try to find yourself, and also the ladies must find themselves, go to school. Very important in our culture that women must be not independent as such. People are not independent, there's interdependence. But you must have your own education, your own, if you are not married, you must be able to still lead your own life properly, without depending on a man. Because this thing that contributes to human trafficking and all of that, these are the problems. So we recognize that, and we said, you know, everyone must go to school, and we help. The school is subsidized by government in South Africa. So anyone really can go to school. There's no one that's cast out of school. If you cannot afford uniform, school uniform, some people in the village will buy your school uniform, you know, and even our organization can come in those kinds of things. So we encourage that, and that women must stand alone.
And you know how you said the name, reminds you who you're, and Nosizwe is your name?
Yes.
And it means?
So her name, Nosizwe. So our tribal names will always, for the women, will always start with an N-O. N-O, and it denotes this is a married woman. And then Isizwe is the nation. So the married woman, who is the mother of the nation. Because she has a role to play in the village, that of the mother of the nation, almost like that of First Lady. But First Lady, it's like you following someone. And in our culture, nobody is following the other. You know, like on women's affairs, for instance, we have no role. They discuss things and take decisions. We don't get involved. And on men's affairs as well. But on community affairs, women are very strong. And they've got, as I say, they tend to tell us. Sometimes I want to say things to the people, and she will say to me, you know, you can't say that. And I'll be like, no, I have to say that. I have to get this straight. And she'll be like, no, you can't do that. And in the morning, I wake up, she's telling me the same thing. And I start to think, okay, you know, in case I'm wrong, let me not say this. But then who wins?
I pray.
Yes, ma'am?
How do you handle people who are severely mentally ill in your village? People who just behave completely unacceptably?
Like somebody who's got a mental problem?
Yes.
Or somebody who's just a rascal?
No, I mean someone who is hallucinating and taking their clothes off in public and, you know, behaving just out of control.
Okay, we have in the olden days, when we were still very close to nature, we had medicines. Because between the medicines, that is the herbs, and the spiritual rituals, that could be healed. But people were pure. These diviners, these mediums, it's a combination. There are mediums. They can just tell you what's happening in your life. But then there are mediums that are medicine practitioners. So you are a medium, you can diagnose spiritually, but also you are a pharmacist, a healer. So those ones were put that, they used to live like, you know, by the river, by the caves, and they have to be pure all the time. They can't be contaminated. For example, if you were a traditional healer like that, or you were a tribal chief, for example, and you are going to officiate on a ritual, a spiritual ritual, that ritual will not be successful if, for example, if when my wife is on her period, you know, if I sleep in the same bed with her, I'm not allowed to officiate on the ritual. I must go and sleep in the crowd, you see. So there's a lot of this spiritual thing. So in those days, the people were behaving in a proper way, following correct things, and things were done properly. But today we have mental institutions and all, just like here. And people are sent to those psychiatric treatments. But the thing that we always encourage is that don't expose the person when you're talking to them that, you know, they've got a problem. Always, you know, speak about the easy things that they will make them feel like they are part of the, you know, and there's nothing wrong with them. So we, community is always rallied to behave in a particular way around that person, and also that person must go through. They, for instance, in our village, there's one guy who has a lot of change. He's got that same problem. He lives in the village, he takes medication, the brother gets a grant from government, I don't know what to call that, like some social subsidy from government, and the brother was actually, you know, using some of this money for his own things, thinking that he doesn't know money. And he reported this thing, and we called him. And we said, because we tried to avoid the conflict, we said to him, you know, we think that Pumeza is actually getting better. How about you give him his bank card and we monitor him for the next 6 months? You know, because we don't want to say Pumeza says you are using his money. This will cause a problem. So we approach things like that, and he had to. Now he can't say no, because let's work together here for this man.
Right.
And he gave him the card, and the guy is fine. He actually wants to take a wife now. So, turns out.
I love that. It's so dignified. You've mentioned the word dignity a few times.
Yes.
And I just really respect that, and I just want to honor you with that, because I think that's something that America could learn from.
Yes.
And so, just saying. But my other question for you is, you mentioned that a lot of the history that you that has been preserved over the last 2,000 years has been oral. And
yes.
Now you're starting to write things down.
Yes.
Oh my goodness. That's huge.
Yes.
So tell me more about how you implement that written history, now moving it from that oral to that written language. What's the process for that?
So, for example, what we do, we have, and this is part of the trust that I spoke about that we run, we have researchers, and I'm a lead researcher, you know, in this work, because I've been doing this work anyway all of this time with other people. So we will go to one pueblo, you know, in the context of here, like a piece of land, and we will take a sample. We will, you know, there's the chief, what do you call it here? The tribal leader?
The governor.
And then the governor, probably within this pueblo, has got this section is managed by another sub-governor, this section, another sub-governor, this section. So we call those people, and each governor has got a committee, a council. You can't rule alone. It won't be able to govern. You need the influential people that are respected there, and that come from custom. They are, you know, all their families have been part of this council. You need them to be part of that. So we sample those people, put them around in a room, and have a discussion about it. So now there will be a white representation of this pueblo, and we do the same thing in the others. And we say, what is the process that we follow when a girl is getting married? From the time, and how do you know? Let's start from, how do we get to know that somebody's gonna get married? The family, the two families, how does this thing get initiated? And then you know, people related, there must be a consensus that this is really what happens. So now, eventually, we've got 30 pages about, you know, marriage, from conception to death, and what happens to these people when they're dead. You know, because married people are not just married and then that's it. Things happen, they age, this one dies, or they divorce, and then what happens to the house? In our context, for instance, if we're married, and if I want, or whatever the reason, we separate, I must move out of the home that we live in. I must just take my jacket and some other pairs of shoes and whatever else that I can take, and I must leave. And everything remains with my wife and the children. Because now I cease, if I divorce my wife, I cease to be the head of this family. The head of this family is my son, who is born by her. So I can no longer come there with instructions in that house, and I'm not allowed in or anything like that. And the village will enforce this. You know, there's no going to the court and, you know, wanting to sue each other, whatever. No, we don't do that.
And wife means house, or wife and house are kind of the
yes.
Home?
Yeah, the home, we have a closer, a word in the culture. When we're talking about the wife, we refer to it as like the home or the house. So the house and or the home and the wife of this man, whose home it is together with this wife, is the wife and the house are inseparable. So you can't say, well, we are divorcing because of you, therefore you must leave. Whatever is the problem that makes us to divorce, if we divorce, the elders don't want to know what happened. Even if she's wrong, you are the one that brought her here. So, out, and you start another house.
I'm sorry, I got one question before you all. Did you inherit your position, or you got democratically elected to your position?
We don't do democracy in the tribal law. In fact, we call it customary law. Democracy causes disunity. It causes contestation of positions. It destroys the social equilibrium. People get preoccupied by who they like and who they don't like.
Okay, so it's hereditary. Who selected you?
No one selects you. It's hereditary.
Oh, okay, it's hereditary.
How you are born dictates who you are and what responsibilities you have in the village.
And
so you have three daughters. Who becomes the next leader?
No, if we don't have a son, but we hope we will, we're still young. If we don't have a son, I know my wife wants a son. If we don't have a son, then one of the daughters, if the elder, it starts with the elder daughter, you know, always it's the elder one, whatever is happening. So if we don't have a son, the elder daughter may say to the elders, how about I become the regent chief until I marry just for some time, whatever. I would like I can perform the duties of my father to honor him or whatever. But this is after my wife has gone. Otherwise, from me, she can play that role. And holding for the son. Even if the son is 1 month old by the time I die, she will be the chief until that boy wants to come back agrees to come back and settle and run the village. Even if then that could be 40 years, for example. Mm-hmm. But she will be known as the regent chief because she's holding for this for her son. And that happens with the daughter also. The daughter holds the position. If she marries, the tribe quickly, the elders quickly call a meeting and say, come, you know that tomorrow we must call a meeting and tell people that you are no longer the chief and this is the chief. Because you are getting married, people arrived here asking for your hand and you agreed. So we can't have the village dictated by some guy from somewhere who is your husband and then at night you come up with new laws and you want to bring them here.
But not the king.
Sorry?
Who do they pick then as the chief?
Who did they pick?
Who will they pick? The daughter marries.
Yes. So I have got a brother, and I've got other brothers, and my father had brothers. If I didn't have a brother, let's say I was only son, my father had brothers. So my father's younger brother, the one that comes after my father, the son, the elder son of that one, if he's in the right mind and all of that, then he will be the one to take over and the lineage will go his way. Or what could happen that while I'm still alive and while my wife is alive, this is the other power that women have. If we decide not to have any more children, my wife can look at the children of my brothers and my cousins, but by cousin I mean my father's brother's children, not my father's sister's children. My father's brother's children. She can look at all this and decide, okay, you know, that boy maybe is like 12 years, 13 years, and you can see this. There's something in there. And they will ask that boy to be officially taken out of the mother's house and installed in her house as her son. And that boy becomes my son. So 20 years down the generation, the story will become like a fairy tale, but nobody will know precisely. That story, because the lineage just comes straight again, because he's really my blood, he's my father's young brother's son. So there's always, in fact, in our culture, there's always solutions for everything. There may be a glitch here, but there's always a solution to it. And everything is by consensus. There must be consensus. That's why I was saying to the gentleman there that we don't have democracy, because democracy says majority rules, but what about the minority? The minority is going to disturb the social equilibrium in the village, and people are not going to be of one mind, set, and people are not going to be in sync. So if we sit and discuss something and we don't come to an agreement, we don't vote, but we say, who is still disagreeing? And I don't agree. Okay, let's leave this matter. Let's come back on Tuesday next week. And again, we postpone until we come to a consensus, until all of us, we have a word that says, So ingaba yele tuna. This way, this sentence is asking, is this our decision? And the people must say, yele tu. Like in parliament, they would say yay or nay. So they will say yele tu, and everyone must say that. If they don't say that, then meeting is stopped. We'll meet next week. Until we all agree that this is the way to go. Yes, let's end.
So is there arranged marriages then at all in your culture, or do you get to choose your mate? And does everybody in your village be able to choose their bride or husband of choice?
The strange thing that is not talked about when people are talking about arranged marriages in our culture is that young people stimulate this arrangement. You see? So, you know, this young boy and young girl, they are in this village and they like each other. But there are certain restrictions, even if they think they are a couple, of which in our culture there's no couple of unmarried people. But you know, but they could be liking each other and be like boyfriend, girlfriend, kind of. They will find ways of meeting outside of anyone seeing them. And they can't, you know, like they will probably, they can't even like kiss or, you know, like, you know, you understand what I'm saying? So, but what will happen is that now, if the mother of the of this young girl and the mother of the boy, they like, you know, like this boy and this one likes the girl for the son, they will find a way of inducing an arrangement. And so the women will arrange this, and then they will take at night, the women will take a spear, wrap a leopard, you know, the tail of a leopard, wrap in this, and then go and put this in front of the house of the girl. So from the boy's side, they will do this and put the spear there, and then tell the neighbor that if they ask him about the spear, you must tell them that it's, you know, from White Rock and this family. And they live. So these people wake up in the morning, and obviously the head of the family will wake up first. Oh, there's a spear as he comes out of the house, and he will know it's called Ukhlole. Somebody's stimulating something here. And the boy and the girl behave as if they don't know each other, they don't know nothing about this. And so then they will, you know, these ones will take the spear and they're worried. What if it comes from the family? We don't want nothing to do with it. So they want to hide it, but they're like, what if it comes from that family? So they'll take the spear and put it away, sort of like you see the old woman in this family, like the grandmother, will like, you know, take a small walk to the house next door and just, you know, just checking you out, guys. I've heard something about a spear in this village. And she's not staying at her house. And these ones will know. They'll be like, oh no, I've heard also, and it looks like it comes from the direction of White Rock, street number what. Obviously, we don't have streets like this. But like once they describe, no, exactly. And if they like that family, they'll be like, oh, okay, that's good. And then she'll be like, oh, okay, no, that's fine. And she will go and tell the husband, my daughter is getting married. She's not saying I hear the spear or whatever. Say, my daughter is getting married. You must send a delegation to go and, okay, this is the daughter. This is the son. You see, the spear comes from the girl's family. Now, because of the spear, my wife instructs me, I must assemble men and send them to this girl's family to ask for this girl. And when they arrive there, people, they are lost, they behave as if they don't even know why these people are here. They give them so much hard time, they ask for so many things, just to see if this family is serious. Marriage is something very serious, you know, so you can't just arrive and then within 2 minutes, we're signing a certificate. Give you a hard time and you must go back and find yourself, you are not sure about this. So it's that kind of a vibe. But it's a very important process, because then you would think, you know, at the face of it, this woman is arranging marriage for this poor girl, Shane. No, this girl and the boy started this whole process. Sometimes they fall pregnant. You know, they make a mistake of doing things that are banned and to a point of falling pregnant. And in the first stages, the girl will run to the auntie's place somewhere in another village. And you will find a way of sending a message to the boy. You better send your people to my family before my father kills me. And they send people. Maybe this guy doesn't have cattle to, you know, to forward for Lobola. What do you call it?
Dowry.
Mm-hmm. Now, the young man will simply send two or three guys to go and capture the girl. And yes, that's why you hear that Africans we adopt, what is it? We abduct women. Yes, haven't you heard that? They will say that because people don't understand what's happening. This girl has fallen pregnant by this boy. She runs to the auntie's place, to the other village, sends a message to the boy. The boy doesn't have cattle now, and he's just started working last year. So we have a provision in the culture. As I said, that is the answer for everything. He will assemble two or three guys, go and capture her. So she will, we call it Ubutwala. It's in English, it sounds bad. It's like marriage by capture. So we capture her and bring her to the boy's family. And she's crying and all of that, behaving as if she doesn't know this. And she hates. She's even confused where they're taking her. And meantime, she knows exactly, oh, thank God. And so this is what happens. So when people come from far and they hear this thing, they look at it with shame, worried about, oh, that's why we hear in the African culture we suppress women and all of this, because they don't know that we are under serious suppression from women.
I just think it's great to see that women have such a positive, important role in your culture. But now, when your children are of age to get married, which I assume is, what, 20, will you go through that whole thing with the leopard's tail? And
no, she doesn't want those things. The boy must come, and she must, you know, basically talk to the boy and find out if she wants her daughter to be married to this boy. You know, almost like we live in a very interesting space because we take things from other cultures and bring them into our space. In the Western culture, you would have maybe dinner with the boyfriend of your daughter. And you won't beat him up and chase him, you know, like at sight. You will, you know, because you want to be interested to see, well, what's going on. Who is this young man? And so we want to start that in our culture to say, you know, bring the boy. Let's see. And she already, I mean, there are things that the girl, the older girl, the 15-year-old, says to her that she won't say to me. And then when she says to me, I get surprised. My daughter will talk about, you know, the other time she was talking about she likes this boy and this boy wants to kiss her. And I was shocked. I don't understand how my daughter can be having that kind of a conversation. But then when we spoke about it, she said, no, I have to be involved in this conversation because she will have it with other people. Mm-hmm. You see, again, I was overruled. They said, you are very right. Have this conversation. I want in on it, but, you know, my daughter will say, it's girls' things. And she will prefer to talk to her, not to talk to me about it.
Boys and girls go to school together?
Yes. We sometimes have, like, girls' schools, private schools,
and
boarding schools, and then you have like a boys' school, but those are rare, and they've got their pros and cons. But boarding schools are generally very, very good. They teach you manners, and you know, thanks to both a boarding school and a good upbringing that, for instance, my wife is so, such a nice person and well-behaved. Because she always, you know what she always says? She always says that the matron in the boarding school was like a mother, always, you know, wanting to know what's, you know, what they're needing. And it was a girls' school that she went to, the boarding school. And I find that very interesting. I mean, I never went to like a boys' school. It was, you know, mixed. But I think we could have benefited something if there was that special attention on, you know, how we should be relating with other people, as they would get those kinds of classes. Let's go. Yes?
So how did you meet?
How did you meet? My cousin, was dating a distant relative of hers. And my cousin's grandmother was sick. She was elderly. And she was very fond of me, more than the grandchild, which is my cousin. And so, and she would come, you know, to with the other relative, with her relative. The descendant relative was dating my cousin. So she would come there and she felt pity for this old man that was not so much, she felt like she was not like 100% taken care of by my cousin and the girlfriend. And she would come there in the morning and she was running a restaurant at the time. You know, she had a restaurant with her sister. You know, and she would come there and cook for her. And bath the old lady, and the old lady would tell me all of these stories, and she would tell me that she wants to take this young girl to the village. Now she was in Joburg for medical treatment, and so that's how we met. And I probably thought, okay, I think she can take care of me.
Village is in the southern part, but that your business is up in
Johannesburg.
Johannesburg. Yes. So how do your children go with you wherever you go? I know you go to vacation in Joburg.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Oh, Joburg.
Yes, Joburg. Yeah.
They call it Joburg.
Johannesburg, we call it Joburg, just to shorten. So the village is essentially, it's 1,000 in miles, maybe 750 miles. From the village is 750 miles from Johannesburg. So, you know, we live 2 weeks in Johannesburg for the businesses. We have two businesses. And my wife here, she runs, you know, a workshop where we service cars and, you know, fix cars and, you know, all of that. So it would be like this busy at the workshop with people having different types of problems on their cars. And she's running that workshop, but as yet she cannot fix a car herself. So she just collects the money and tells the mechanics what to do. And we've got a very good head mechanic, like the head of the mechanics. So so I spend 20% of the time in the workshop. Really, even if I go there, you know, they complain because I'm still on the phone talking to the village or, you know, to the people about the Vusizwe global business, the arts and culture. You know, arts and culture business is supposed to be a business run by traditional leaders anyway, because we are the custodians of arts and culture. So I feel it's an obligation like that. So we spend 2 weeks here, 2 weeks in the village, and then 2 weeks there. So now, like now, we're here. When we come back, we have to check what's happening in the businesses, and then we have to go to the village.
Can you show us your map? For those of us who are geographically challenged.
Okay. So let's do this. Do you have a...
Oh, yes.
Can everybody see?
There you go. Thank you.
Yes. So I'm not much of an artist, as you can see. But this year, can you guys see that? I don't know if you can all see it. But so this would be Africa, right? And here we've got what you call North Africa. So this is the Arab bloc, where you've got all those countries, Algeria, Libya, and all of that. And then here we've got West Africa. That's why you've got Ghana and Mali and all of those countries. And this side here, it's East Africa. That's why you've got Kenya, the Maasai people. I think it's one of the well-known tribes around the world. And then you've got Central Africa, where you've got like Congo Brazzaville and the northern and almost the Democratic Republic of Congo is supposed to be there. And I always say that that's where America gets its cobalt for its jet engines from here. If we can switch off the apply here, your jets basically will be grounded. And South Africa is here. So that's why we've got the Atlantic and the Indian Ocean. And that's why I was talking about the Cape Point down there at the bottom. Now, South Africa, so that little thing there that we do is like the Cape Point, where the Indian and the Atlantic Ocean meet. So Johannesburg, JHB, will be somewhere there. And our village will be somewhere here. So we have to travel this distance all the time. And then Cape Town, I think everybody knows Cape Town. Cape Town is right there. And the distance between Cape Town and that is 1,000 miles from Johannesburg to Cape Town. Exactly 1,000 miles, because in kilometers it's 1,600. So, and there's a little country locked in there called Lesotho. Those who've been to Southern Africa might have heard of that country. It's a small country. Have you know about it?
Yeah, I'm from Botswana.
You're from Botswana? Botswana? Yeah, Botswana is. Botswana is here. And it's a, and it's a big country going that way. So our village is somewhere here, and this is about, from the village to the ocean, it's about maybe 1 hour, 20 minutes to the Indian Ocean. And it's quite nice because we are not right close to the ocean, which is always a contested tribal land, because property developers, all of that, they're always trying to get that land back. They're always trying to get that land to own it. So now the village itself is structured like this. And you have six administrative areas. So we live in one of them, so this would be like the northerly direction, like north that way. And we live in one there, but each village has got between 8 and 10,000 people. And so each village has got a headman, the guy who's in charge, the sub-governor. Sorry? Yes. And so that's how the government is so there's a little regional offices, and the head office is where we live. So if there's a big thing, big problem, whatever, they must bring it.
Are these the administrative areas?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, these are like administrative areas that are under one office that governs this land.
And which is the same as Nelson Mandela, where he came from? This whole area, or?
It's right at the north, because that's another chief from Nelson Mandela was a chief. He was the head of a tribe. Nelson Mandela. I don't know if many people know about that, but he's a tribal leader. And that's why his grandson today is a tribal leader. So he comes from somewhere about here. And it's called Kunu, Q-U-N-U. And that's where his grandson is a tribal leader today.
And where's the Xhosa versus Zulu? Is that over here where we figured that out, or?
No.
Because I kept saying he was Zulu. I thought it was a Zulu leader, and it's not right.
So this is Lesotho. This is another country. Very strange, but
right in the middle.
Yeah. And this here would be one kingdom. So all the 42 tribal leaders in there, they've got one supreme king. And this is Xhosa. And then here, and with the border of that country, this is Zulu Kingdom. So we are neighbors. We speak a language that's almost the same, actually. But it's different, but we understand each other.
What did you say? There are how many languages that you generally are spoken within your area?
We have 11 languages.
11?
11 languages in the country. And so this area here, we'll speak, we'll have a language group, and the other area, there's a language group, and the other area, there's a language group, and then there's Afrikaans and English. That, throughout the country, people can speak either both or one of the two. But generally, in South Africa, to get along, to be able to, you have to speak at least about 5 or 6 languages, and then you can communicate all over the country. You can't just speak one language. Otherwise, you'll struggle.
So, like 11 different languages, how different are they? Are they incredibly different? Or
some of them are like English and Greek. There's just no word on the other language that you can, it's like English and Chinese. But you have to try and learn one or two languages in each language group. So that if you understand this language, at least the ones that are close to that language, you can understand. You won't speak fluently and you won't write fluently, but this is just to communicate. But the people in that area, they learn that language at school. And they speak that language. And they decide when they're talking to you whether to speak to you at the level of communicating or speak with the beauty of their language. And when they decide to go deep and speak with the beauty of their language, then listen for hours and not even understand what they're saying. You hear the words, but the way that the sentences are constructed and they're speaking in anecdotes and parables and this, you get lost. They could be talking about rain, you won't know. And then there's another language that the women don't know. So there's something that women don't know. So when we're in the initiation school, we have a language for them. And this language is made up of the words that we use every day. But the way we construct the language is such that they won't know, that it has no meaning to them. A sentence has no meaning to them. And this language, you have to learn it immediately when you get to the initiation school, because that's the language you speak then.
When you talk about initiation school, does everybody picture like a building with a school? And it's not. I don't know how it's different for women, but you were talking about how it is.
It's a period of seclusion. So you are taken out of the community, out of society. And you are in a spiritual space, in the forest, in a round hut. Picture the pictures of the Red Indians that you've got here, where there was a round hut and these people live here, and they are not dressed, nothing. And you can just put on a blanket if it's cold. And you put on white clay, and basically, day in, day out, for the first 8 days, there are certain rules. You can't stand up, you can't do this, you can't do that. It's for you, it's for you to teach you discipline. Obviously, you get circumcised on the day that you arrive. So part of the process here is about healing, and part of the process is about being taught about things that, and how you should behave. And the pain that comes with the circumcision is not even the most important thing here. It's the training you are going through. And this pain is just to remind you that life can be tough, and you have to be stronger than anything you come through. That's why a man is not allowed to cry in our culture. If you want to cry and you are very emotional, you must say, gentlemen, I just want to go to the loo a little bit, so I'm coming back, and you compose yourself. You get there, and then you come out, and you say, gentlemen, now, you know, this is what must happen. You have to be strong, because your wife and your children cannot see you doing that, because you're going to make them weak. You know, this is the belief. So even if I'm hurt by something, because of this training, my wife asked me, aren't you, you know, don't you have a headache? Are you fine? Aren't you depressed? I said, no. She thinks maybe I must take a painkiller or something. If some, you know, things are stressful in the village sometimes, you know, the old government issues and whatnot. And there are people causing problems for you sometimes and all of that. So, but we try to be strong. Yes?
Your English is amazing.
Yeah. You think so?
Yes.
Very good.
And so I am, one question I've got, when did you start learning English? What age were you?
Because when you go to school, we are taught in the village where I grew up, we are taught in our native language everything, even maths, they speak in the native language when they are teaching us. And they explain this. Even when you go to the English class, they teach you English in the native language. So, but then you know, when I was maybe 12, I started to get interested in this thing of writing letters. So I'll write to my uncles in English, and my father used to love to read a lot, so he would give me readers, digest, and newspapers, and say, read this and tell me what's the story here. And that's how I got to like to read a lot. And when I travel a lot around the world, I realize that, you know, if I'm speaking to people, I must speak very clearly, not try to speak in an accent, just speak the way I would speak in the village, but try to make every word to be audible.
Thank you, great job.
Yes.
How many languages do you speak? In the village, you may have languages, how many are there?
The native languages, and there's 9 of them, but there's Afrikaans, which comes from Dutch, and then there's English. So there's 11 in total, but the native languages, there's 9 of them, and out of that, I speak maybe 5. Just to communicate, some of them I'm not very good, but I can say everything I want to say, and I hear everything they're saying. And you train yourself, you open these radio stations, you know, to make sure that you keep the language going.
You know, because actually, in the Netherlands, they have so many dialects, and people from different towns in the Netherlands can't understand one another because of the dialect they call. It might be the same. You must speak the same, the different ways that they say their words. But you all, like, you have a different meaning for each word in that language. And
yes.
It's amazing.
It's like, basically, it's like French and Chinese and English. So, like, if you take somebody that speaks only French and somebody that speaks only English and somebody that speaks only Chinese, they can talk anything. Those people. And that's what happens in the village. And some people are like that. They can't, when they go to other places, they can't talk to people there. They have somebody to say, oh, they are saying hello, you know. And you look like you're stupid because you are from, you know, around here, it's just 3 hours away and you can't talk to people. And then there are people in other areas where they can speak almost all the languages. Like in Soweto, some of you would know Soweto. Those of you who know about a bit of, you know, maybe the struggle history and the uprising in South Africa, Soweto is the biggest township, and it's a melting pot of people coming from everywhere. And people there can speak all the languages, all of them. They just talk to you, and if you don't understand, you speak in your language, they switch, they speak your language.
When you go from from area to the six, the five other areas, you know, you understand everyone in those areas.
We use one common language for them. Use one, and this is the language that we both speak, because otherwise you can't preserve, you know, this history and some of the things, the beauty of the long years. So we have to speak one common language.
Well, she's from a different area, right?
Yes, but then she ceased to be a member of that community.
Yeah.
Yes, and when I go there, I have, you know, I'm treated so well. Because, you know, I'm the son-in-law, and everybody just wants to do something nice. So you're not allowed to go there, like, every weekend. Otherwise, people will be poor. Always they're doing something, you know, giving you things. You know, you have to be considerate.
So you and your wife moved in with your parents for 6 months after you were married?
Yes. No, we didn't move in. Remember, the eldest son does not move out of the house because it's his house after the parents. So, like here, you would have all your sons move out, and then they just say, "Oh no, my parents' house is there, but my house is there." The eldest son is not allowed to move out. You have to stay in that home, and this home, the job of the parents is to transfer it. You know, all the responsibilities. Like they tell me about things that, you know, my grandfather and my grandmother, the relationships she used to have and how to do things and how to relate to so and so and how to relate to this, whatever, all of that. If there's a wedding and the tradition is that we do this to this family, we have to take some gifts or whatever, she has to know all of those things. And you can't write those things down, and you have to know them. Complex.
Boundaries. It avoids chaos.
Yes. We don't have, generally, we don't have chaos. So, for example, if your husband has got brothers and your husband is a chief, these sons from these brothers, they know their place, their role is to support your eldest son. And they know exactly that here their role is to serve that eldest boy. And the young brothers to that eldest one, they have to do the same thing. But then they have a little bit more power because they are born directly from the same woman. So they have a bit more power than the others. But so everybody knows their place. And it is like that.
What were you talking about when you compare it to the British monarchy? Monarchy and how they just changed their interpretation of that because William wouldn't have the power that he has now.
Yes.
Because of the bloodline. Yeah.
So in terms of heredity.
Yeah.
So Queen Elizabeth, for instance, you know, in the traditional sense, Queen Elizabeth was supposed to be the regent king. And she was supposed to, once she gets married, hand over to the father's brother's son. You see?
Yeah.
And then that makes William, I mean, the first one is Charles. Prince Charles would be, you know, he would be from the royal family, it's fine, but he would not be next in line. And William, really, nobody would know William. Because it would be in no other book, even when you write the, you know, the succession, the genealogy, he would not appear anywhere. But, you know, they've since, and I don't know if they've officially, I don't know what are they trying to do, but it's going to be, from now on, they are going to find it difficult to change what they've done now. Because the succession has been changed to descend from men.
Right.
And now it descends from the queen, and it goes to his son. And I think they were undecided about that, and they decided to jump to the Because the next king, from what we see, is the grandson.
William.
I mean, yes, William. And the question is why? I don't think they could answer that. So it's got to do with benefits, resources, luxury, and all those things.
So is it hard to keep the youth in your country, in your culture? Do they want to leave, or are they very committed to your culture?
They're very committed. They're very committed. They like it because, you know, it's nice when there's these traditional events and, you know, these festivals and all of that. It motivates people to see the beauty. Even with our own people, when people are fully dressed in the traditional regalia and you are in town, maybe you're passing, you're going to attend some event, people, they just, you know, greet you and compliment you. She always dresses, you know, like in traditional gear. And always in town, people are, you know, because they don't know us that they're in town. And some of them, maybe they know us, but we don't know them. And they always like complimenting you. So they like it. And so now people, like with the arts and the culture, the craft and all of that, they just, sometimes they just decide to wake up and dress like that and go, you know, maybe to church or wherever. So they embrace it. They like it. They like it so much.
Has it always been that way, or has there been times where they wanted to...
At the height of Christian influence, it nearly came down that level of excitement and pride. But people soon realized that, hold on, you know, we are these people. And we can't link ourselves to any other genealogy. So there's just no other way. So they decided. So throughout all of the history of South Africa, of colonization, of apartheid, of whatever, culture never died. It's the one thing that remained intact. Even when the colonial government, you know, the colonial government would depose a tribal leader, and the magistrate would write a letter and say that we are deposed. And the tribal leader would accept the letter when it's delivered and tell the people. And the people would say, okay. And then the following day, they come and consult their traditional leader. Because it's not the tribal leader they got from the government. It's a tribal leader that is born for them. So they never took it serious. Even in the Zulu kingdom, if you can read about it, there's a king that was actually, you know, St. Helena Island, somewhere in the middle of the ocean. I don't know if you guys have heard of it. They once took him for 9 years and put him in there. Somewhere in the Indian Ocean, you fly for hours to get to that island. You know, to try and disturb the Zulu kingdom. The people, you know, they reported to his younger brother. And when he was brought back, they thought that now they've managed and he has no power. The thing came back and people were just so happy that their king came back. In fact, they felt stronger that he conquered this incarceration. So they actually made them more powerful by that thing that they were doing.
Is it your company?
Yes, Precisway.
Yeah, so you have, for instance, they have the you have the rights to represent and distribute this opera about Nelson Mandela's. What's it called?
So Nelson Mandela's, the clan that comes from in the kingdom of Obatim is called Madiba clan, you know? So that clan, a man, we cannot address each other with our first names, same with women. So once you go to initiation school, I'm not supposed to call you John. I'm supposed to call you by your clan name. So he was called that and he became, you know, in prison everywhere. And so like he became the most popular Madiba. So the play, the opera is called Madiba, the African opera. And really it's about tracing his life from birth, the influence, the cultural influences, the influences in the great place, the tribal government headquarters, we call it the great place. And a lot of things happened there that shaped the people that grow up there, they become different from others because they have, you know, certain training that they go through. And all of that, and that's how we became the person that you are. So that tribal, so this play traces all of that until 1963 when he got arrested. Because a lot is known about him after that. But before that, nobody knows the people that even decided for him to go to school. It was not his parents. You know, one of the elders in the village says, Nosegen, to the mother, Nosegen, you must take this boy to school. Look at him. There's someone here. And they arrange with the other guy, and that's how he got to school and all of that. So this play traces those kinds of things and tribal festivities that you know, he would, you know, be part of. And he would listen to the court cases when the king is, you know, because he then grew up in the king's household. And when the king was, you know, having visitors or whatever, addressing people, he would stand behind a big tree because the tribal court is outside. He would stand behind this big tree and listen to all of this thing. And that's how he got to decide to study law and to be so articulate like the way that he was.
And you're, when you, so for instance, when you get the rights to do this, it's because you want to share the culture and the traditions of South Africa with the rest of the world, right?
Up until 1994, what was known about South Africa and really generally about Africa is that this backward place, we live with monkeys and you could be eaten by a lion, you know, like those kinds of things. I mean, when I was in China, I was shocked. They were asking me, when did I get these clothes that I'm wearing? In the media, they asked me this thing in media interviews as if we, you know, and they were shocked that I look like I'm somebody that has taken a bath a few times. So Africa has been known like that, and, you know, with the wars and apartheid and all of that, and our duty as tribal leaders is to resuscitate the good image, the real image, in fact, about Africa and what it's got to offer. And that, in doing that, the elders are saying, you must do that, export, because then the generations that are coming, the generations of the information age, of Mixit and WhatsApp and this, they will be asked these questions on WhatsApp by people in Europe and elsewhere, and they will realize, I better know more about my culture, because my friends in Michigan are asking me about this, and I don't know. So we have to make it, take it to other places to tell the story, but to make our people jealous that these ones that are coming after us, they must be more excited about knowing more, to not be embarrassed.
Where's the state that you said that is technologically advanced more so than a lot of places?
It's actually in West Africa. It's in Kenya. It's about four hours flight, 4 hours from South Africa by flight, from Johannesburg, actually. From my area, maybe about 5.5 hours by flight. And Kenya is so advanced technologically, actually. If the Kenyans in the capital city, those who are like, very technological savvy, they came to, like I was asking, the people here, they still use the post. Some people get a check in the post and whatnot. That's like 1910. They don't do any of that. And they're so advanced, even more than South Africa. South Africa is like a superpower in Africa, but they are more advanced than us. They will take a very basic phone. This phone here, we bought it just to make a phone around. It's like $5, not 50. Five. One, two, three, four, five. And the Kenyans can do a 10 million rand business transaction here. You know, like press some code and whatnot, and they'll transfer money to you and to you and to you and whatnot. And so these are some of the things, of the stories that must come out of it. For people to understand that Africa is open for business, but Africa is a cultural destination, and Africa is more serious than ever. We may very well have some few dictators left, but it's not all bad.
Yes, we're about done. They have another event coming in, so I want to thank you so much for sharing your culture with us. So, thank you very much.
Going to get them back next year.
Oh.
Yes.
Kelly?
You have to turn this off.